Hello and welcome to Chinny Vision. Strap yourself in, it's Afterburner. Afterburner, 1987 arcade game by Sega. An Afterburner, of course, is a type of reheat for aircraft, and it could be said this game is a reheat of Space Harrier. Certainly the same type of scaling technology used in the game. Now, I've got to say this before we start. There's Afterburner and Afterburner 2. And frankly, for the layperson, they're the same game. Some people are going to be screaming at the comments about this, but really, for the purposes of this video, we're treating Afterburner and Afterburner 2 as the same game, because nobody apart from the hardcore fans is going to spot any difference at all. And this is going to be a long haul. I think we've got 13 systems here, so we better crack on with it, starting off with the Amstrad CPC, because it's the version I had, ported to the home systems in the UK by Activision. And I had a disc version. Didn't always load on my Amstrad. One of the few games that could be a little bit unreliable. And you have all these balls spinning around to show off the scaling. The arcade has this, but the Amstrad has a very simplified version. And I haven't played this for years and years and years. And this, every time it says disk access, remember, it's going to be loading from tape. So something to keep in mind there. Because I think on all the 8-bit versions, it is a multi-load. So the familiar aircraft character, and off we go, and it scrolls right down. It doesn't just disappear, it scrolls down smoothly there. It's straight into the action. No in-game music on the Amstrad. And this is the end of stage. So you basically fly around. I mentioned Space Harrier earlier, and it is Space Harrier, but with more restricted movement. Even on the arcade version, it's more restricted in terms of how you move around. You can roll, you can slow down, you can speed up. On the Amstrad version, you press the space bar to change the speed, so you just have to tap it to make it do what you want. You get these nice sequences like landing on this runway here. Well, there's no runway, it's runway in the other versions. You just get a line of trees, little men run away, and a motorbike follows you up. Game is very, very samey. Sometimes missiles will come behind you and you've got to speed up, which can be not. I think there was one there, but I managed to get out of the way. And there are the bonus levels like Space Harrier, and this is replicated on the Amstrad version here. You fly between walls, basically. I don't know why they're walls, because they're not walls in the arcade. They're more like standing stones. But still quite nice, and it's mode naught on the Amstrad, and it's moving along very nicely indeed. On most of the versions, including the Amstrad, your machine guns fire all of the time, which means you just point your aircraft in direction and you hit the enemies. And you have missiles as well, and you get refueled with missiles every so often. And when the red light flashes, as it did there before I died, there's something behind you. Over to the MSX, running this on my new MSX2. And hey, look how great the picture is. Because even though my MSX1 had RGB, this is looking quite nice, actually. And somebody said to me recently, Chinny, stop stretching the games on this channel. We don't stretch the games on the MSX because it's PAL. Everything is squashed up. And the same applies to systems like the Master System as well. So this is how the MSX in PAL land here in the UK displays this game. And this is effectively the Spectrum 1 to 8K version, except squashed up. And it's going to be a bit slower, I imagine. And you've got the same graphics as the Amstrad, but that little 1 to 8K there, even on 64K MSX, because it's ported from the Spectrum. Oh, and a much slower takeoff than the Amstrad version. But it speeds up a bit more once you're in the air. And you do have some music, which is absolutely dreadful. Waiting for something to happen. And there we get some enemies on the screen. And the red light flashes because they're coming from behind you. Nice clean graphics here on the MSX. Obviously with the limitations of it being a specky port, not optimised at all. problem with these UK MSX games. They just quickly ported the MSX, mainly for sale in Holland and Spain, done the minimum time. When we come down to land, the music slows down as well when there's a lot going on this version. It is quite playable. It is just a little bit slow, and the music is just, well, I say a bit annoying. It's really getting on my nerves now. Over the Spectrum, loading this off my Hit Squad tape. And oh yeah, you can see a definite speed increase there, even on the menu screen here, with those balls really spinning around much faster than the MSX. Yeah, and takeoff is much faster. But it's going to be essentially the same game. Yeah, a lot more turn of speed here on the Specky, much more playable. I should have 1 to 8K music, and I don't. Don't know why. Loaded it up a couple of times. My Plus 2 just ain't playing ball on this. So I imagine, because I've tested it in an emulator, the music is the same as the MSX version, basically. So just imagine if you've got 1 to 8K, you've got that music, that dreadful music from the MSX. So probably not much of a loss, really, here. It's a really nice turn of speed here on the Specky version of Afterburner. It suffers, again, like, well, the arcade and the CPC version, the other versions, of just being a little bit repetitive. Those little blocks that go around the enemies are lock-ons for the missiles. So when they lock on, you just press fire and the missiles home in. We should have a crash animation, a little crash animation there. As we go down, we rise up again. You have to use the speed strategically, and you can see me changing the speed from time to time. You generally run at this speed, kind of speed here we are at now. You can slow down if you need to. It's done on the spacebar on these versions. Can be annoying because sometimes you can press the spacebar, and if it's in the wrong part of the sequence, you'll slow down rather than speed up. Over the C64, this is the European version, and you'll see why that's important a little bit later on. And you start off over the sea, and even though it's level one, you're straight over land. So it should be sea. And you've got some music. It feels much more constrained than the other versions so far. Your main sprite moves around. It's nice to see the C64 scaling stuff fairly well after the C64 version of Space Harrier. And of the versions we've seen so far, the music on this version is a little bit easier on the ear. You are playing in a window here, and you'll see why that's important to mention this a little bit later on. I personally think the C64 version seems even more repetitive because you're constrained in, and it just seems to be wave after wave of baddies coming at you. There's also overlap issues when the enemy aircraft go over the ground, and you get blue blocks all around them. Your aircraft doesn't suffer from it. There you go, you just saw a little bit there. And also the explosions get little blue blocks around them on the ground as well. Shame. On the C64 version, you do get the bonus level, and it's better than the Amstrad version. You get these passageways you fly through. A bit more authentic to the arcade rather than walls. I do like that explosion as well, even if the colours are a bit off. Every third level or so, and I think it is actually third level, you get a refuelling opportunity as well. Either your refuelling aircraft comes down, or you land on an airstrip. And on this level, the explosions look really horrible against the grey ground. Weird colour choice. Yeah, that looks really messy now, actually. On the early levels, it wasn't such a problem. This looks really horrible. No. That's just... If it's going to look that bad, why not use a different colour scheme? Because it wasn't so distracting on the earlier levels. And there's an American version, a US version of Afterburner. And this is it. Released by Sega themselves. Kind of up, run, get ready. Fun, really, isn't it? And it's full screen. And it's a little bit slower, but it is full screen. And you've got the sea. and the explosions are much nicer, and you haven't got those clash issues with the ground. The enemy aircraft pass over the ground, and it's perfectly fine. That said, I find this version much, much harder. But it's far more polished, and it's full. I really do like this full screen. Although I don't think you get any warning of how many when the enemies are behind you or how many missiles you've got, from what I can see. You do have that radar at the top right, but nothing else. Interesting why there is a US version and a European version. Speaking of US versions, here's another US version. We're running this on my Amstrad PC2086 because it's the PC MS-DOS version, released in 1989. And we run this in VGA, NEC V30 processor. Not sure how well it's going to run it. And that tune is terrible on the beeper, and believe you me, it repeats over and over and over. But nice graphics, as you'd expect in VGA. Bit of floppy disk access. Because I've been asked about this when we do PC versions, we're also going to look at the EGA and CGA versions as well. The aircraft takes off and flies off at an angle, very nice. And this beeper tune, yeah, is terrible, and we'll get a new nerves very quickly. Running slightly slower than the C64 version, but I guess you probably need a faster processor than I've got. Still, very nice detailed graphics. I'm wondering how this would be if it's running a bit faster. Missile comes towards me and hits me. I find on the PC version that the missiles are incredibly hard to avoid. They seem to just, even when you take evasive action, they still seem to hunt you down. Whereas on the other versions I've played, they seem to give you a little bit of leeway. As long as you make enough of an evasive action. Oh, I like that explosion. If you make enough of an evasive action, you escape them. Whereas on the PC, they just seem to follow you and follow you and follow you. And it's a shame down the bottom that status panel is rather a bit shoddy. Why are there no icons on there? Why is there not multiple colours on the speed? Missiles is listed as a text and number as opposed with icons. Everything at the top is just, it's all just a little bit lackluster outside of the main gameplay area. And on to level 2. Oh, I haven't had music as bad as this since playing Rick the Roadie. There's a reference for anyone who's played Rick the Roadie on the Amstrad. Oh, the music on that's terrible, and the music on this version terrible. Oh, I like the engine on fire there as you crash down as well. I wonder what this is like on a 286. I bet it's actually pretty good. On this processor, it's just a little bit too slow. But it might be faster in EGA and CGA, so let's go and have a look. Here we are on EGA. I've tried to count the frames. It seems to be about the same frame rate as the VGA version, but to me it seems a little bit faster. Placebo. I don't know. The graphics are very close. Colours slightly more muted just because the palette. I don't know. Effectively the same game. And this is the CGA version. And this is very slightly faster. That sky is really annoying. Why they've stippled it. Just a little bit more playable in CGA, although, as you'd expect, ugly as anything. Oh, and the music is now kind of as annoying as these terrible colours, but yeah, a little bit more playable on the CGA version, just because I guess it doesn't have to throw around quite as much graphics memory. Over to the Atari ST, this version playing on my Argonaut, who of course did Star Fox and Starwing, or slash Starwing rather. Perhaps we're going to get some really flashy action. And it's nice to be on one of the 16-bit gaming systems, I guess, after the PC version. Smaller window, but more pace. Some nice music. And oh, we've got sample. That's a sample speech as well. And there we go, rolled the plane. That's a really important evasive manoeuvre. And I do like how those planes scale. Oh, that's nice. That is nice. I do like that, even though they're a little bit blocky. You get plenty off if you hit the pause key. But I'm... Right. Yes. And the status display is similar as the arcade. And you've got everything. It's much nicer. Why can't they do this kind of stuff on the PC version? It always seems to be this era of PC games. It always seems to be slightly lacking. Anyway, really pumping out a tune there. I quite like this. It's certainly polished. They've certainly tried to replicate the arcade version on the ST. Got a little bit of scaling going on there with those planes come behind you. And I keep on saying it. I really do like that. Game seems to slow down very, very slightly when the sampled speech is playing. Shouldn't do. I don't know if it's having to access disc or something. I don't know. Just seems to slow down very slightly. And that can happen sometimes. You can end up dying twice in a row because you're not invulnerable the moment you respawn. We're going to come in for landing, and then we've got an airstrip. Oh, that's nice. And we've got plenty of missiles to carry on our mission. There's the motorbike. Oh, he doesn't speed after you on this version. You just go past him. The enemy, 9 o'clock. Sample speech is a novelty at first and then becomes a little bit annoying. So let's see what they can do on the Amiga. And we got sampled music, as you'd expect, nice and authentic to the arcade. More colours on this title menu. Looks very, very nice. Although worryingly squashed up, which indicates ST port time. Also by Argonaut on this version. Can also play this game on the mouse if you're absolutely insane. Any arcade game should be played on the mouse? Lemmings is a puzzler. I'm thinking proper arcade games. Space Harrier on the ST. That also played on the mouse, didn't it? That wasn't very good. Well, slightly shoddy disappearing of the carrier there. It just kind of plops out of view. Now, I'm playing this on a 1200, so this could be running at the wrong speed. I'm sorry, I couldn't get the 600 out to do this. But at least we get an idea of the graphics and the scaling. It seems pretty good. It is squashed up, which means it's SD Portville. It looks very similar to the ST. I wonder if there's going to be sampled speech. I wonder if this is... It just seems a little bit too smooth and fast. But it's good fun. I mean, you've got 1200 that's accelerated. You could have some fun with this. It's... Always complain you never could quite get the speed of the arcade versions in the home version. Well, perhaps you might not get it on the 500 or 600, but you're certainly going to get it here. The music's a bit sample-tastic. All the sounds are coming out of a sample pack that have been used by about 100 other games. So it doesn't sound quite as good as it could. Nice and easy to roll here on the Amiga version. Some of the versions aren't too easy to roll the aircraft to get out of the way. It's very similar to the ST version, really. Just with nicer music and squashed up graphics, and so far, no annoying sampled speech. But hold fast, because like the C64 version and the PC version, there is a US version of this game by Sega for the Amiga. So let's take a look at it. Indication of things to come, a nice title screen there. and we're down the carrier in a much larger screen. And that's a nice takeoff sequence, and the music already sounds far more authentic to the arcade. Now, it's not quite as smooth as the Argonaut UK / Europe version, but the graphics here look far, far nicer. They appear to be trying to replicate the arcade far closer, as you expect a Sega in-house project to do. Feels like a slow version of the arcade, the scaling's much better. I really do like this. Nice explosion there as well. No, this isn't bad at all. I think it's a step up from that UK version, but then again, the problem we know with the UK conversions is they were done under very limited time, and it was always a problem trying to make the game as good as it could be. Over the Sega Master System version, I don't actually have a box for this. It's one of the few games I only have a loose cart for. And will it be like Space Harrier on the Master System, or will it be a step above that? Now, Space Harrier on the Master System was pretty good, although slower than the original, and probably the best you could expect from a home 8-bit console. So we take off. It's looking good already. Especially coming off that Amiga USA version. Yes, it's very... Well, the frame rate's much lower. No indication of how many missiles you've got, or lives, or just have that radar. But it's playing pretty well so far. Very easy to roll as well. And again, that's a critical, important part of the game in terms of avoiding the enemy missiles. Because you have to be able to roll. I think 60Hz, and this is playing at 50Hz, the game would be a little bit faster as well, which helped make it more playable. It's just a little bit too slow, but it really looks the part. If you store a still of this game, you'd go, that's a really good port, and actually it plays really well. There's some nice colour fades between the levels. One problem with the Master System version is it doesn't give you any continues. You have to go online and find a cheat in order to activate continues, which is quite annoying. Because it's not an easy game to play, and to offer no continues at all is a bit harsh. I really do... This tries to... If the important thing about a home port of a game is, does it capture the essence of the arcade version, then the Master System version does a pretty good job. Now, over to Sega Mega Drive. This is Afterburner 2. Now, we're not going to get into that mess. It's Afterburner. Okay, anyone got a problem with that? Tough. Lovely scaling of that big 2 in the middle. Looks so nice. Lots of options you can choose from. Easy, and you can choose some music options and change your controls around as well. So you've got speed and your missiles on the joypad. Really, I just keep on saying it, that I love that scaling after all those 8-bit versions. And here we go. Oh, it's lovely and smooth. Oh, this is so nice. After all those jerky versions. You know what? After playing all those home versions, I know this isn't arcade perfect. It's like... the arcade version. It's really nice. I mean, the thing is, today you can play the main version and play it straight against this version. You go, yeah, this isn't accurate. And actually, compared to some of those versions I was playing, even on the Amiga and ST, this immediately, just on level one, feels so right and so close, even though it isn't. again comes back to that thing I said about capturing the essence of the arcade. It looks good. It plays well. And so much better than Space Harrier 2 on the Mega Drive, which was a massive letdown. And again, like the Master System version, imagine this in 60Hz. I'm sorry, because I know a lot of people watch Univision in the USA, and I have to play on 50Hz here, so you guys will know what speed this actually runs at on a 60Hz system. And oh, this is fast. That caught me out. And yes, we do get continues in the Mega Drive version. Oh no, I've done that wrong, because now I'm outside the thing I need to fly down on this bonus level. And I get back in. Dare I try and edge back in, because I want some points. Oh, you can't. There's no way you can do that. I really like this. I'm probably going to get it in the neck for saying it, because it's not accurate enough. For a home port from 1990, this blows everything else away. And there we've got a missile behind us. And just managed to escape that by powering out of the way. If there's an enemy aircraft behind you, sometimes you need to slow down. And if there's a big missile behind you, sometimes you need to speed up. And it's much easier to use the speed controls on the Mega Drive version here compared to the other versions, especially those 8-bit versions, where you're just randomly tapping the space bar. And sometimes you go, no, I wanted to speed up, and you're in the wrong sequence. So the next time you press space bar, you slow down. Just annoying. Now, there's one final version to look at, and we've been going at this quite a while, the Sega Saturn version, which we looked at Sega Ages on here before. We'll have a quick look at it, and yes, it's using some of the arcade code. It's not quite perfect to the arcade, but to the layperson, you're probably not going to spot the difference. It's, again, much, much later than all these other versions we've looked at. I'm not going to dwell on this Saturn version, just wanted to show it a little bit. So that's an absolutely massive roundup of all the versions of Afterburner I have here. It's a great arcade game. I don't think it's quite up there with Outrun and Space Harrier, but oddly enough, on the home systems, it manages to get better ports than either of those games. On the 8-bit versions, the Speccy version is pretty nippy and plays fairly well. The MSX version is the Speccy version, but slower. The Amstrad version, it's full colour, it plays really well. I played that quite a lot back in the day, and just coming back to it, I'm reminded of how much I played it. It wasn't a game that was on my consciousness that I played a lot when I started this review, but actually, I played Afterburner on the CPC quite a lot, which means I must have liked it. C64 version, it looks and sounds promising, but sometimes it ends up in a graphical mess. And it also seems much more repetitive than the other 8-bit versions. It's not bad, and certainly it's got all the scaling stuff working really well. Although, I'd say check out that USA version, because it looks far more polished and is full screen. On the 16-bits, you think the ST and Amiga version are pretty good, until you play that Mega Drive version, which just blows them away. Even that USA Amiga version is completely blown away by the Mega Drive version, which is, by having spent a lot of time playing all these different versions, and suddenly arrive and get the Mega Drive version, and after things like the MSX and the C64, you suddenly go, this is arcade perfect. It's not, but really, for 1990 for a home system, it is. The PC version, well, back in the day, the problem was that it was slim pickings, wasn't it? If you play games on the PC, you play what you could get hold of. And actually, it's a fairly competent port and probably needs a faster processor than I've got, and a sound card if the game supports that, because the beeper tune will do your head in. Sega Master System version, yes, the frame rate is pretty dodgy, but it captures the essence of the arcade game better than any of the other 8-bit versions. If you want arcade perfect, or as close as you're going to get to it on the home version, then yes, it is the Saturn version. For me, of Space Harrier, Outrun, and Afterburner, Afterburner was the third choice in the arcade. But on the home systems, on all of these versions, I think it's got more solid conversions than either Space Harrier or Outrun got for any of these systems, barring the Saturn. It is a game that has restrictions. I don't find it as much fun as Space Harrier. I find the movement of the plane too limited and the gameplay too repetitive. And sometimes on the arcade version, just the game is just far too fast to play. Space Harrier, I don't really think you can ever throw the accusation at it. But I think if you're going to play a home version on an 8-bit or 16-bit version, do pick out the Mega Drive version. I think it's seriously impressive.